Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining us for our webinar on inclusive and accessible STEM education, technology as a tool to empower students living with disabilities. This webinar is organized by European SchoolNet in partnership with the STEMIT, Scientix and STEM Alliance projects. My name is Elena Vitsioti. I am a project coordinator for European SchoolNet, and it is my great pleasure to be your host this evening. In this webinar, we will learn from experts in the field of inclusive education who have spent several years finding solutions to make STEM education accessible to students living with disabilities. We will discover the result of research and projects in the field and technical solutions offered one of our STEM Alliance partners. Before I introduce our speakers, please let me go over a few housekeeping rules. My colleagues Rocio and Eddie are available in the chat to help with any technical support you may need, so please do not hesitate to contact them if you need any assistance. They are also sharing a link to the signature list for this event. Please take a short moment to fill it, as it is important formality for us to be able to organize future events. In addition, only by filling this form you will be able to receive a certificate of attendance for this webinar. Finally, we will be taking questions for our speakers in writing and try to answer as many of them as possible at the end of each presentation. So please feel free to ask any question you may have for our speakers in the chat. Our first presenter tonight is Dimitrios Chiastoudis, a PhD candidate in the Didactics of Physics in Aristotle University of Thessaloniki and part of the STEM Education Research Group, as also a high school physics teacher for over 18 years. For the last 10 years, Dimitrios has taught at Special School for the Deaf and Hard of Hearing in Thessaloniki and has been involved as a founder of Open Hub. Open Hub is a non-profit organization located in the branch of National Foundation for the Deaf and Hard of Hearing in Thessaloniki. Open Hub, as partner organization of the 2021 STEM Discovery Campaign, ran online after-school STEM courses during the pandemic, aiming to cultivate technological literacy for deaf, hard of hearing, and other students with sensory disabilities. Based on his experience, Dimitrios will provide some recommendations, general rules, and useful tips for designing accessible online courses through the Moodle platform. Dimitrios, thank you very much for joining us today, and the floor is yours.
Hello, everyone. And I will try to share my presentation. Okay, so let's go from the start. Okay, I hope everything is okay now. My name is Dimitris Chiastoudis, and I am a PhD candidate at the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. And I'm here today to present you the preparation, modification, and accessibility checking of online STEM courses for students with sensory disabilities and especially hearing disabilities that we run in Open Hub. And I am a science teacher in the secondary school for the deaf and hard of hearing in Thessaloniki, which is in northern Greece. And Open Hub is a volunteer group of teachers for after-school classes. We had to stop our activities because of the pandemic the last 2 years, but that was just an opportunity for us to change and try to make this activity online. So we decided to design courses that can be attended online by our deaf students. And to do that, we use Moodle, open source educational platform, because first of all, we are fans of open source software and provides flexible learning and has the appropriate security, and it has a form that can be easier integrated. And also our students can follow the activities even from their mobiles, and this way we can make our courses accessible for all. For those who don't know what Moodle is, it's a platform that comes at the start with a set of plugins, let's say some bricks that are all ready to run, but we can also choose from a million of others to design our own courses according to our needs. We can separate the groups of plugins in four basic actions. We have plugins that are used to store educational material that help us to produce communication between students or collaboration, or even to help evaluation of our activities. This way, following the educational method of our choice, we can make our own special synthesis and achieve the goals we have set it for the course. And so when we try to make the e-course for deaf students, we discover something like a new place of the digital world that was always there, but we didn't notice it. Our purpose was to design a course for educational robotics with Arduino, as also 3D printing with Tinkercad software. And furthermore, we wanted to make the appropriate modifications for the deaf and hard of hearing students, and also to explore modification for the blinds too. And that was when we discovered WCAG, which is the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines. We weren't aware of it before. And the story is that there is the World Wide Web Consortium, W3C, which develops web standards such as HTML, CSS, etc. And the Web Accessibility Initiative, WAE, is a part of W3C. And following the W3C processes to develop a web accessibility guidelines, technical specification, and educational resources to help make the web accessible to people with disabilities. And which are those guidelines? Well, there are four principles of accessibility. The content should be perceivable, operable, understandable, and robust. And what do we mean by perceivable? This means that users must be able to perceive the information being presented with at least one of their senses. In each general guideline, there are steps that someone has to follow to accomplish the requirements. Text alternatives are a common modification to establish accessibility for the visually impaired. And of course, Moodle gives us the opportunity to set the appropriate text. There are some guides you have to follow to choose the right alternative text for every picture. This is an example of a photoresistor where we had to attach this text in order to be accessible by blind students. Of course, our deaf students has complete access to pictures, but that's not the same for videos. In that case, we should add descriptive subtitles to all videos that had voice guidance. And also, the content should be adaptable. We should prepare it to be presented to the way that can be presented in different ways. And all deaf students are not the same. Some of them have cochlear implants, some others know very well sign language. And so everyone has to choose his own way to access the material. And making the videos with sign language was a really hard job for us. And we have to take in mind also that our content should be distinguishable. And that means that our voice recordings should be very clear. And we had also to pay attention to the background of subtitles, which is a difficult job for videos. The second general rule says that our content must be operable, and that means that the content's interface cannot require interaction that a user cannot perform, and that's not an easy requirement considering the different hardware every user uses. It has to be operable through PC, through tablet or mobile, or you have to take in mind all these kinds of hardware. And also, It has to be accessible by keyboard. Touch screens and mouse is the usual way to navigate through a course, but for people with sensory disabilities, perhaps the only solution is the keyboard, and so the course should be, all the course and all the educational material should be accessible through keyboards. And sometimes the voice instructions were too quick, and we had to change the rate of the video in order to have a reasonable time to read some titles, especially for deaf students who have some difficulties in reading, and we have to take in mind those two. The third general rule describes that content should be understandable, and that means that the content or the operation cannot be beyond their understanding. In our project, we had to pay specific attention to have an understandable content, since robotics are not familiar to deaf community, and we have faced a lot of sign language issues with missing words and signs. Specific guidelines to make a readable context include the necessity to avoid URLs or click here indicators. It's difficult for blind people to understand what is there. And also, surprises might be an interesting thing, but it's not the accessible way to design inclusive content, and so we avoid them. The content should be predictable by the users. And we also had to add language assistance in users' interactions, as also to give them the chance to review, to confirm, to reverse their submissions in order to help them to interact with the content with the best way. And the last principle is that the content should be robust. And that means that we have to take in mind the way that assistive technologies interact with our content. For example, cochlear implants, we have to see how students with cochlear implants are using the educational material we had. And so we designed questionnaires for specific testing users and take the appropriate feedback to modify the content. And also, Moodle provide a great tool for testing the course accessibility. When you have designed already the course, you can add an accessibility review block in the course and examine the accessibility issues that might have. This toolkit give feedback for issues that escape our attention. For example, as I said before, URLs that might exist, and we can modify them again and suit the appropriate guidelines and proceed. And I can say that in general, Moodle helped us the most to make this transformation, to create inclusive courses that could be accessible not only from PCs, but also from smartphones that are always arising from our students. And the last thing I would like to talk is that deaf society faces extra accessibility issues that are related to the difficulty they have to learn spoken languages, as also that every country has its separate sign language, and it's difficult to exchange information between different countries. And I'd like to say, speak about the collaboration we have with five schools in an Erasmus project. And in this project, we have a high school for the deaf and hard of hearing in Thessaloniki, a deaf school, secondary school from Bursa, Niloufer, and Mr. Levent from Belgrade, and from Torino and from Veles. And in this project is called My Hands Are the Mirror of My Culture. And we are using technology to produce cultural stories of our countries in all sign languages. And so every deaf can see the culture of the other country in his own sign language, but also to see and examine the other sign languages, to see the differences and interact away with the other countries. It's a very promising ongoing project, and we're looking forward to see its results and disseminate what we will find. As a future work of Open Hub is we will try to enrich STEM sign language vocabulary, because we have major issues in, how to say Arduino in Greek sign language, or how to say new words that come in. And when deaf community will engage with this part of knowledge, they will construct their signs, but they're missing now. We'll try to provide more STEM-related courses. We will try to collect and analyze the data of our students and see how can we update our material, and to create even training courses on how to design accessible courses for the deaf and hard of hearing. And I think that's all I have to present. I would like to thank you for your attention, and please don't hesitate if you have any further question to send me an email. I will be happy to respond to every question you have. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dimitri, for this super interesting and inspiring presentation. And we will make sure to include some of the YouTube links in the presentation before signing it on Scientix, so participants can have access to directly your work there and the videos. If you have any questions for Dimitri, please do not hesitate to post them in the chat. We will collect them and address them towards the end. Thank you. Let me now introduce our next speaker, Nikolaos Narantzis. He's a Scientix ambassador for Greece with a lifelong commitment to helping students living with disabilities, and has been working as a physicist in the special education at the secondary schools, supporting and promoting scientific education to students, while inspiring and engaging many other colleagues to explore innovative ways of teaching and to promote science education. Today, he will present Having Fun with Scientix, a pilot implementation of non-formal education in the context of Erasmus+, standard protocol procedure in 2016, which during workshops on electricity, astronomy and light aimed to teach STEM topics in a playful and practical way, nurture group dynamics in education and give equal chances to people with and without disability to participate in a project. Nikolaos, thank you very much for sharing your experience with us tonight, and the floor is yours.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for the invitation. It's a special honor to be here as a Greek teacher and a Scientix ambassador. Let me try to share my presentation also. Take a moment or two. Until the presentation will be shared, let me notice that. Why I can share? Can you see it?
Not yet. Maybe in a few moments.
Now?
No, not at listening.
Let me try again. Okay. I think that's better.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, thank you. I have to notice that this project wouldn't be implemented without Ευδοξία Παναγιωτίδου. She's a psychologist in an office, special office of the Ministry of Education, and she has the idea in order to implement all this stuff. Let's see what was this having fun with science. It was a pilot project with participating 11 the high school students with and without disabilities. For example, we have two students wheelchair users, two with hearing impairment, one with visual impairment, and one with language disabilities. This kind of mixture, let me say, it's a little bit difficult to find it in a Greek school. Perhaps you have two variabilities in a classroom or something like that, but it was very challenging how to combine all these unknown students together and make a dynamic group. The project, as Eleni said, was a pilot implementation in the context of an Erasmus project back in 2016, and the objectives were to bring all these students in the science, in the know of science, with a playful and practical way. We wanted to connect the knowledge with the scientific knowledge with everyday life, and of course all the students were unknown between them. The main aspect of course was to give equal chances to each participant. The venue was my then school, was the public secondary junior special education school, a very spacey room, a school with big rooms, with elevators and all the special aids we needed in order to implement the project. And let me walk you through the three workshops. Every activity you see here, it's about 20 or 40 minutes. It was three long weekends, as you can see. And
Nikolaos, only one comment. Sorry for the interruption. We don't see the slides moving, so please make sure to move on to the next slide, please.
This is. Can you see the picture?
We can see the initial slide, but not the second, the third.
Why? No, this is not good.
Now we can see the ice breaking and embodied activities.
But I am out of the presentation mode. But why? Now it's the intro. But
yes, yes. Now it's intro. It's all good.
It's intro, and now it's the about slide.
Not yet. Perhaps you need to move them manually. So please click on slide 3.
Yes. Now it's better. Intro.
Now we see the venue.
It's taking too long to change. Let's go back to the electricity. Why? This is not. Okay. Electricity?
Yes, perfect.
Okay. I'll do it manually. Okay. This was the first workshop. Seven activities, 20 to 40 minutes each. When the group wanted to make a break, we give them a break. So seven activities. There are scientific activities. They are energizers in order to make, let's say, more cheerful or more motivating the group. If we have to lay back our time, we stop. Okay. The first activity was to know us better. Name tag activity, to combine a name with an adjective so everybody can learn each other's name. There are also other activities like organic micro mixer, and you can choose many of these energizers. After this game, we have ice breaking. And it was the activity of electricity transfer. We do rows down to the to the pavement, and everybody can move like an electron. We have people to stand here or there to make, they say, the role of the resistance, of the role of the energy of a battery. So we have to give, let's say, caddies or to take caddies. And that was a nice breaker because we have to say also our names. This is also an embodied scientific activity, and with a playful way, we give all this content in a scientific, how to say, codex. More or less, we can pass on in hands-on activities today to make batteries with lemons, to give some hands-on activities, and have a lot of helpers also in order to give aids or assistance whenever students need it. Every session, every workshop was closed with an evaluation. This type of evaluation is to put, let's say, a green sticker if we like it, or a yellow sticker if you don't like it a lot, or even a red sticker if you like it at all. The evaluation process can take a time, and of course we can give directions, guidelines, and what to discuss the feelings and what we have learned. In the second workshop, it was about astronomy. We can see here that we had five activities. The first activity, it was called the minefield. It was a very interesting activity in a volleyball field. We put some chairs and everybody have to pass the volleyball field with the chairs and the net with their closed eyes. We make them all blind. We have fun, and then we go upstairs. There is a big auditorium, and we presented a video on planets and constellations, how we can recognize some constellation in the night sky. We have a series of tactile material, 3D printed, or object like an apple, a balloon. And this was, and you can see the right picture, that was the relative size of the planets of our solar system. For example, here down at the right, the Earth is like a small potato. The balloon is the Jupiter, and the apple is Uranus or Neptune. In the parallel, we had tactile material, as I said, either in a swell paper or a 3D printed plastic, as here with all the constellations. Next activity was activity zones in three special parts of the auditorium. We put some special activities to have some crosswords, or to have some tactile material, or to express themselves in a paper. A very, very laughable activities. Let's be stars. We pass on to the group the constellations, they choose one, and they had to represent it in the space with some candlelight. So here you can see the constellation, the Orion. Okay, they had to put the relative sizes and to stand there without or with no help at all. The closing activity for this workshop was a free expression of the paper. They can write feelings, emotions, knowledge, or feedback they wanted to give out to us. Passing to the third workshop, here we can see seven activities. Let me say it from now, the seventh were implementing, the group that what feel it to do it. The first group building activity was pantomime. We choose something and someone pantomimes it, and the others have to fight it. A lot of fun. Next scientific, let's say, activity is to embody how the light jumps. As you can see down the pavement, we have colored A4 papers, green and blue. this is something about when the light passes from a crystal or from a glass, it's like we jump on the rocks in order to get along a river. That's how, let's say, light go through a crystal. So we have to embody this activity, and you have to put each of your foot in the color paper and to pass along the river. Okay. There were also numerous of hands-on activities with lasers, water, plex glasses, color lasers, and that was a very fun activity also. And with everyday life material, you can have all this fun. Just a jar of a fish tank, let's say, a small fish tank, with water and two drops of milk, you can see reflection, total reflection. You can talk about optical fibers, and we added also small videos about history of life and the science of this. The evaluation method here was the three jars. We had in these three colored carbons the activities, and if I like an activity, I put water in the specific jar before of the carbons. Another evaluation method was reporters. In small groups, the students search and discuss and present something about a subject they wanted on this material, and of course they have to present their findings. The last activity that was the worst happened was the string toss game. You have a ball of yarn or string, you say something about the workshop, and you pass it to another one, and you make a web, let's say, and you can see all the connections. Let's see what happened, what the objectives, and what we have kept from this implementation. Of course, the process was challenging and very interesting, of course, difficult. We had to spend a lot of time in order to organize this. We had a group of very different needs. It was difficult to choose games and activities. You have to read a lot. We see in the next slide. It was very tricky to adapt all these chosen games for every disability. Of course, it's very tricky and very motivating. We needed a lot of material, some extra costs came up. We have to see all about multisensory aids, and you have to throw it and to organize it with every little detail. For hearing impairment, of course, you need someone with sign languages, and you need extra facilitators or helpers. So what went okay? The 3D printing, the braille tactile material, even for the not blind students, was a surprise. They love it. The lasers were a very fun activity. Large papers, presentations, colors, audiovisual material, speaking slowly and clearly with simple instructions was a plus keys to this workshop. Many tips to make it accessible. We have to ask the participants, even in advance, what are their needs, what is helpful for them. You have to read a lot about your subject or how to make it happen. In this specific workshops about non-formal education, what activities and the structure of the activities, to ask advice from colleagues, to use our knowledge and to make everything better, and of course a lot of group thinking with your helpers and facilitators. what we keep in mind. We always have to have not only a plan B, but a plan C or D. You have to be flexible and adaptable. Have a lot of facilitators and helpers that really helps, and you have to go with the flow. You have to take the pulse of the group and go from one direction to another if you see that something is not working. And of course, use multi-sensory aids. Okay, that's all for me. Thank you very much. Let me stop sharing.
Thank you very much, Nikola. And okay. Yes, everything is fine. Thank you so much. And before we move on to our two next speakers, we have a few questions for Dimitrio and yourself. So I will start by the questions for Dimitrio. You mentioned creating content in simpler layout. How can you present complex STEM materials in simple layout, such as equation, for instance? Maybe we have a connection issue. So until we have Dimitrio back with us, I'm moving on with the questions for Nicolò. Did you find it difficult to conduct the workshops combining students with disabilities and students without any disability?
At this special occasion, really no, it was very good organized, and the students were already, let's say, prepared and anxious to participate in this workshop. If you go to a more, let's say, general aspect, for example, a classroom or a workshop, you have to inform a priori your students what are they are going about to do. This is very crucial, and they give you some positive thoughts about this. As I was saying, we ask about their needs, about what to make more easier, more accessible according to their needs, in order to access some content or the specific contents.
Thank you very much. And from your experience, did you find that certain activities or topics are easier to address and approach for groups with different needs?
In general, no. We can make accessible almost every activity. And the 1-8, for example, the 3D printed material can be also a triggering for, let's say, a student with hearing impairing or learning disability, not only for blind or sight deficiency. You can have small, small surprises. More or less, I don't know all the activities in the European schools, because we don't have many hands-on activities or many experiments taking the students the action. It's very motivating for them in order to engage.
Thank you. And you mentioned extra costs. Can you be a bit more specific, please?
We had to buy the swell paper package. It's almost at this time was the cost was 80 euros, and we have to find the special, let's say, breeder, or the special it's a special machine that you put the swell paper inside, and you have this tactile material. In fact, we bought everything ourselves. that was the story. The plexiglass or the laser touch. Okay, this is the low cost, but I don't have a 3D printer. I have to find a friend that has.
We understand. Thank you. And lastly, for teachers who teach mixed environments with students with and without disability, do you have advice to help students with disabilities so that they don't feel different?
This is, let's say, a matter of attitude. We can go inside, okay, everything is, let's say, variable. Okay, let's say we are persons, we have the variability and the, how can I say, the impairment, the disability is the, sorry, I try to translate, is the outcome of our interaction with society. It's not an a priori situation. The disability is it's the outcome of the interaction of the society. If society and my environment helps, I won't feel disabled at all.
Thank you very much, Nicola, and many thanks to you and the team behind Having Fun with Science. Finally, it is time to introduce our last speakers for the evening. José Rubio-Fillo is the co-founder and CCO of Key2Enable, a company that developed a complete set of assistive technology composed by hardware and software, and that is an all-in-one solution for students with disabilities, with which any other accessories in the market can be connected, enabling them to communicate, learn, work, play, engage, and deliver contact, local or online, curriculum-based or supplementary to their homes, schools, clinics, and rehabilitation centers. José is a mission-driven serial entrepreneur who graduated in electronics and business administration, creating sustainable businesses that benefit social impact, education, and health sectors for the past 20 years in Brazil. Today, we also have with us Stella Magid, a science ambassador for Israel, a member of the STEMIT and STEM Alliance Career Advisors Network, and a STEM head teacher at Tamarot Ayaloch Inclusive Secondary School in Tel Aviv. Stella is a keen user of Key2Enable assistive technologies. In their talk, they will explore the possibilities of integrative assistive technology inside classrooms and create a fun interactive environment that can stimulate the students' level of engagement and fulfill their true potential. José and Stella, thank you so much for being here with us today, and the floor is now yours.
Thank you so much. After this introduction, I think I don't even have to introduce myself. Let me see if I can share the screen. Can you see my screen?
Yes, perfect.
And is it going to the other slide?
Yes.
Okay, just to be sure, because sometimes you have these glitches. So I'm José Rubinger, I'm from Brazil, and I'm the co-founder of and CCO of Key2Enable, a company that developed this solution comprised by hardware and software solutions that enables children with motor, physical, and intellectual disabilities to be part of the educational process and excel in their development. Thank you for the introductions. Thank you, Dr. Nicolaus, for your amazing presentation. Let me try to see if I can call your attention as Dr. Nicolaus did. So we usually say that we need to build a path for people with disabilities to thrive, to expand their creativity, their critical thinking, to make them communicate and develop their skills and talents, which will make them feel empowered and independent. Well, maybe I took this out of Google and I just put it here. First, I have to say that sorry for my English, because I'm from Brazil and sometimes we forget some words, but please help me if I do that. So let's see if what I wrote here is true. What we have here is Amanda, and she's playing with Sophia. Amanda was born with cerebral palsy. She cannot hold a pen, she cannot talk, but she's playing with Sophia. Actually, she's teaching Sophia how to use our solution. And they stayed there for more than 1 hour. I was the one who was taking this video. And she was not even saying a word, but they were interacting. They were playing with each other. Here, we also have Amanda playing with João Paulo. João Paulo is a gifted child. He has 11 years old and is already attending the university. And here they are playing and there is no difference. And why is that happening? Because there is something that both of them are using to interact. And this is our keyboard. I'm going to show you a little bit more of this. But here they are playing against each other. And you will see that João Paulo will try to play on her turn. And she won't let, because the best has to win. So that's when it happens. Hey, this is my turn. So they are playing against each other, and this is happening because they are playing together with a technology that can make them interact. And it was all designed by this man. He was born with cerebral palsy, and he graduated in computer science using a head pointer. And he created what we call now KeyX. because he wanted to make it better for him and for other people that were born with cerebral palsy, for example, that could not access a computer. And then we came in and we started building the solution together with him. You can see here that it's full of colors and buttons, and it works as a keyboard and a mouse. So everything that we have in a 144 keys in a computer, we can reproduce the same thing here in this platform. Here you can see that when we went to schools and rehabilitation centers, what happens is we saw that many people, many children could not even touch the keyboard. So we decided to manufacture other kinds of accessories that enables them, even if they can only touch a button, even if they can only press a pressure button, for example, it doesn't matter. We can make them communicate, we can make them use a computer, and if they can use a computer, they can do many things. Of course, I'm talking here about people that had their brain stimulated when they were young. But if they didn't, it's not a problem, because you teachers can help them to achieve this. And the interesting thing is, we are talking about the Scientix, and the name of our solution in Brazil since 2015 is TIX. So we are in the same pace here. And we also have other platforms that we call Telepathix and Fluentix. Fluentix is a predictive test that helps them to write much faster. And here you can see how Telepathix works. This is a person, for example, that can only move the hand, and she's using a tablet to communicate. And when you finish, it can make a sound, so it's easier for them to communicate. So this is Telepathix. Again, Telepathix being used by a child who can only blink, and he's blinking and selecting the words. This is a software that for now, for example, we are making it for free. You can download it at Google Store. It's called Telepathix. Any person can use it. And here is how the keyboard actually works. So Abdullah is writing the name of his teacher in Arabic for the first time. Here you can see that he is typing the letters of her name. It's Mona. It's the first time that he's using a computer. It's the last word that he will. That's it. He did it. The most interesting thing here is that he is so happy. Give me five, Abdullah. Give me five, Abdullah. So this is what these kids are doing. But it does not stop there. Imagine a kid like Allison that was invisible inside the classroom. He knew everything, but he could not express himself. And when the solution started to be used inside his classroom, he cannot hold a pen, but he has published 3 books already. So in his city, he's known as Allison, the writer, not Allison, the kid that was born with cerebral palsy, because Allison can do whatever he wants. Here we have Marina. It was the first keyboard that we launched in 2015. So she went through the university and graduated in journalism. Now she is a blogger. She wrote like 2 or 3 books already, and she's doing a great job there. It's not only for children and for young people. It's for old students like me and Dr. Regina. She graduated in got a Google certificate. It was the first Google certificate for a person that could not use a regular keyboard. And she's doing this using our solution. Why it works? Because you, teachers of special education and teachers that cares for people with disabilities, for children with disabilities, you have the commitment and interest, and you really help us. This is happening in Brazil. This is happening here in the UAE, where I am. This is happening in Chile. This is happening in Portugal, in Israel, in Spain. And because of Impact EdTech and the STEM Alliance, we help. We want to be there with you, trying our solution to pilot This was in Yerevan. All the teachers had the opportunity to work with the solution. And sometimes we see this kind of things. Children without disabilities playing with kids with disabilities. Usually this is not possible because they do not interact. But here we can see again how it works. A child with 4 years old is teaching the other child with only 2 years old to learn a lot of things and words. Imagine 2 years old learning about words. It's all possible because of this educational platform that we developed, not because we wanted to develop, because you teachers asked us to develop something that they could interact with. So here we assign the buttons, the colors to the tasks and activities, so we can build any activity in any language like this one that it's in Arabic. Any curriculum, K1, K2, K3, K4, it's up to the teacher. Of course, we have our curriculum and many tasks that were already developed. And this is like the first screen of the platform. And I will let Stella Margid to show you how it works, because she was the one who was piloting our solution in Israel. So I will invite my team, my Avenger team member, Stella, to continue this.
Stella, you are muted.
We cannot hear you.
No, we cannot hear you, unfortunately. Maybe something with your speakers? No, you're not muted, but we cannot hear you, which makes me think it's not the microphone, but maybe the speakers.
Can you see the little mic there, Stella? Maybe.
No,
we cannot hear you. I think that maybe if she tries to go out and come again, maybe.
Yes,
it's better because we were hearing her. In the meantime, as she does not come again, let me show you other things here. And as soon as she comes back.
And in the meantime, we have received some questions for you. So maybe we can proceed.
Okay, that's it. If we have some questions.
So you offer solutions for students with motor disabilities, but are you also developing or considering developing solutions for students with blindness or deaf or hard of hearing?
So this is a very important question. What happens was we know that there are a lot of interesting materials and interesting solutions out there for blind and deaf. And as I live in Brazil, we were visiting schools and we were not finding many affordable solutions for people with physical and motor disabilities. And then we decided that we should go in that way. So we can act together. We can actually use our educational platform. And we have, like, for example, a teacher that is blind, and she is teaching the kids with our solution. So yes, we can do some things together, but our solution was not developed to be used by them.
Thank you so much, Rosa.
Can I try? Can you hear me now?
Yes,
we can hear you.
Thank you. Thank you, Stella.
Okay, thank you. That was the problem and with the reconnecting. So I'm sorry. And now I will upload my presentation. Okay. So just a second. Okay. Okay, so I'm going to speak about inclusion with Key to Enable. I was one, as Jose said, of the pilot teachers of K2Enable solution. We tried it last year with Impact Ed Tech project. I'm from Israel, and my colleagues, Marcos from Spain and Carmela from Portugal, also used it in their country. All of us, you can see us with KeyX, with the hardware that Jose spoke about it. I want to introduce myself a little bit. I'm a STEM educator and STEM pre-service and in-service teachers trainer in Israel Institute of Technology. And also, I'm a STEM teacher at Samarot Alon Secondary School. And our school is the first inclusive secondary school and high school in Israel. Inclusive school, it's the school where in each class with 25-30 students, there are around 2-3 kids with disabilities that can be physical disabilities or mental or intellectual disabilities. So kids study together in one class, but sometimes they have different tasks. So I tried this solution last year, and it was a COVID year when we have in Israel lockdown, half a year. So, and also it was my first year as a teacher in inclusive class. I'm a teacher for almost 20 years, but last year it was my first year with that kind of school and that kind of students. So I used it during general science classes and also during some teaching and spending hours with my students. Our students are 12 to 13 years old, and half of my teaching was face-to-face, and it also was remote teaching according to the situation in Israel. So I used the Expressia software of learning boards. I will show you later the solution and the board that I built for my students. So this is the example of a learning board, and it's a science class when we learned about the properties of materials. So during this board, there is a question, for example, about one of the properties of materials, and the answer should be the picture. Okay, for example, that the answer volume. So it answers the question about volume, mass, strength, water anomaly. So students should pick right answers. That the board that I built for them last year when we studied about this topic, it was a summary of our teaching learning process about this issue. What I want to say that the solution, from my observations for the whole class, and I made a small experiment with the kids, because half of the group didn't use the solution and half of the group used it, and then they have a task about the topic. The solution improves the communication between students with special needs and other students in the class. They try to solve it together and to play with solution together. The solution improves reading skills among students with dyslexia. Last year in one of the classes we had a student with this disability. It improves creativity skills among the kids with special needs, because they after they saw the board, they could create their own board by themselves. And the solution improves students' knowledge in a STEM subjects, and it's one of the subjects. I will also show you board about other subjects as solar system. About one kid with disabilities that was in this class, he didn't want to communicate with other kids. He sat next to me in a small table, but he was in interaction with me all the time. So there was an improvement of communication with the STEM teacher, and the very improvement of communication with classmates when he explained his board to other kids. He didn't want to work with them, but he wanted to introduce his work to classmates. Increase of interest in during STEM lessons, motivation, and his creativity, because he worked with a key to enable software, also with KeyX later, and better understanding of STEM topic. About my personal point of view, I think that the solution is simple and very interesting for teachers, because there are many possibilities, and you can enrich your lessons, STEM lessons and regular lessons with this platform. Another interesting thing is that last year, from the beginning of the year, in September, kids didn't study at school in whole class. Because of COVID, they were divided to two small groups that in Israel were called capsules, and they didn't know the other kids in their class. So later it was lockdown, and in January, when they came back to school and they become one class, instead 15, 30 kids, they become beginning to knowing each other. So with the help of the solution, I made some interaction with kids, and they had to build their learning boards and games in different groups, and to meet their new peers in the class. What's going today, these days, here in school year? I have a small class that is called Coding for All. There are only seven boys, that each of them has some disabilities, a few of them with autism, dyslexia, there are some mental problems or fears, intellectual problems, but these kids like computers and they like to code. They don't like to interact one with each other. They like to work by themselves. They like to program by themselves. For example, they don't like to ask me for help. For example, there is one student that can sit 1 hour on one line of code and he can't find a bug, and he doesn't want me to help unless after 1 hour, if he doesn't succeed, he asked my help. So they are very individualistic. But they like computers. So I showed them the solution and Express in the beginning of this year. And they learned it very quickly, like 15, 20 minutes. They could do their own boards. For example, they like computers. So one of them built a board about the different parts of computers. For example, you can see what is CPU, and the answer is one of these. A picture, another like a Minecraft game, so he built some shapes from this game, so they liked it very much, but they didn't want to interact one with each other. So I decided to do something else. In our school, we have in the first floor, we are secondary school, the primary school, so there are kids from first grade. So we decided that they will preparing learning boards to teach the first grade students, because we are in the same building. So they were very excited about this idea. Again, you can see there is also another girl, but she quicked out. She didn't like programming and computers. So they worked very hard, and they were very inspired with the idea that they are going to teach the small kids. And before they present their board to little kids, we did like feedback presenting and feedback session in the class where a teacher their peers gave them some feedback. For example, one student presented his work about different flags because he wanted to teach the kids about countries and flags. So they interact one with each other through the presentations of everyone's work. And when we came to teach the small kids, they were very excited. For example, you can see this student in seventh grade that teach Hebrew ABC. In Hebrew, it's Aleph Bet, the small kids with Expressia tool, with the board that he built, and they liked it very much. They participated. Another kid teach about flags, international flags and countries. And also the girl who quit, she liked it very much, this board, and she taught them about different animals. So the interaction of these kids with smaller kids and the teaching, their teaching process, unless although it was very short, like every one teach for 5-7 minutes, but they liked it very much. It was a good interaction, and they were very happy about it. And also it was a contribution like to the society, because they should do some project of contribution to society. So to teach kids from primary school, it was their contribution to the society in our neighborhood. So the problem with building boards was not technical, but I understood that there was a problem about asking question skills, and it was their difficulties. For example, when they started to build their boards, and one kid wanted to build his board about football stars. So he built very nice board, and also he taught me, because it's not my topic, football stars, but every question was, who is it? And when you see the question, who is it, and you see Pelé, Maradona, and Messi, you don't know what's the right answer. So I understood that we should work on asking question skills, because the question should be specific for the answer, for the picture. For example, we improved it when the question is, which famous player passed away last year? There is only one answer, and it's Maradona. And which famous player played for Paris Saint-Germain? It's Messi. And which famous player, 81 years old, it's Pelé. So they improved their boards with specific questions because they need one specific answer that is shown as a picture. About my suggestion for educators about Expressia. Okay, and after my presentation, I will show you the solution from my computer. This tool, Expressia, is a free of charge friendly tool which is connected to the Google Library. So through a few seconds, you can find a pictures that will be an answer to students' questions. Teacher can prepare learning boards to evaluate learning material, the summary of material, or if you want students to learn through the tool, they can learn the material through preparing of learning boards by themselves, and according to the educational theory, learning by doing. And preparing learning boards might improve their communication, asking questions, and presenting skills. About Simplix, platform that Joseph shows you and showed you, and I also will show you now. It's a great environment for kids with different kinds of disabilities, and it's very nice that you can use this board with or without a KeyX hardware. So it's up to the teacher. Okay, so that's it for now, but I didn't finish because I want to share the solution from my computer and show you different boards and possibilities. So it will take 1 minute. Second. Just a second. Okay. So I'm going to share the Express solution. Okay, so I will show you some board that I created. Okay, for example, the board that it fits primary education for primary kids. It's about the four seasons. Okay, for example, just a sec. No, that's not. I have a lot of things that my kids also did. Here it is. Okay, about four seasons. There are specific questions about winter, summer, autumn, and spring. It's very short, but students learn this subject in the first during first grade at school. So this is one of the board that we prepared together with my students for this small kid that they taught them at school. Another board that I want to show you, it's not a science board, but it's educational boards. I won't open it because it contains many pictures, but this board that every teacher can present about every kid in the class. For example, there are pictures of every student, and you can ask a specific question about every student, and other students must guess whom is refers to. So this is very nice activity that you can do in your class in the beginning of the year when you want your students meet and connect one with another. Another nice board that I didn't create it, but it's in a library of Express and it's online. So I only translated it to Hebrew, and I will show, for example. Okay, so I translated it with my kids. It's a great activity, and it's also fit a primary school because they must to guess about animals according to its shadows. About Simplex, the other platform, it's also have different boards. For example, you can teach road signs. Okay, it's Israeli. I created it for secondary school students, and they learned every sign for their test. Another board that I'm sorry that I created. I'm sorry, just a second. It's about Passover holiday in Israel. There is a meal, and this is the ingredients that should be in the place. So also kids in primary education checked the meal and tried to guess what's supposed to be there. But I want to show you STEM boards, and it's here. There is a board about a solar system. Okay. Okay, through this board, students can learn about solar system. Also, there is a specific question about every planet, and students like this board very much. The board about family day, when we had it in Israel, I create a family dayboard for them. So very in Simplex, it's very nice because there is an automatically tool that it can say what you write, and also there is a possibility that you can put here your voice or music, and it's very, very nice for kids. And the last one, it's also four seasons, but it's not a regular four seasons. I wanted through this board to expose them to classical music. So the classical music of Vivaldi, Four Seasons, when students pick the right answer, for example, during this season, the trees are become golden and red. And when they put it on autumn, there is a part of the party refers to autumn. So through this board, we also, students were exposed to classical music. So I think that's all. And Jose, if you want to add,
If I add anything to my Avenger teacher, I don't really know what I can add here. Thank you so much, Stella. You're doing a great job. It's unbelievable. I will be very soon in Israel to see this in person.
I will be very glad to meet you in person.
Thank you so much, Stella and Jose, once more. It is a great pleasure for us, to the team at the European School, to see how you interact with each other and how tools supported in the context of the Impact Project are being used by the Scientix Ambassador community in Israel. It means really a lot. We have received some questions for you, and we will address them now. But now that the connection issue has been restored, we have a question for Dimitrios, and I would like to get back to it. Dimitri, you mentioned creating content in simpler layout. So how can you present complex STEM material in simple layout, equations, for instance?
I'm really sorry, I had some problem with the network. I didn't hear you well. Can you repeat it, please?
Of course. You mentioned creating content in simpler layout. How can you present complex STEM materials in simple layout, for instance, equations? I think the connection is not very steady, and I'm going to also post the question in the chat.
Education robotics. Let us make it step by step.
Or maybe it's my connection. Rocio, can you please confirm if you can hear Dimitrios responding?
No, we could. We cannot hear him well.
Okay, maybe we lost him. And now it seems to be a bit more reliable, and I have also posted the question in the chat. Until we figure it out, I'm moving on with questions for Jose and Stella. You offer amazing solutions. Is the hardware expensive?
No, the hardware is not expensive. This is one of the hardware. This is the Kiex. We call it Kix in Brazil. Talking about assistive devices, Because assistive devices usually cost like $5,000, $10,000. We see here things costing like more than $30,000. The KeyX now, if you need only the equipment, is around $1,200. And of course, we are looking for selling or building around 10,000 units, and this will make the price go down. But until we reach that quantity, we still need to make it in this price.
Thank you so much. And how do you think that teachers can collaborate in order to improve the platform overall?
It's a very important question. I sent in the chat the link of Expressia. So for the teachers that are part of the STEM Alliance, and if they want to join Expressia, it will be for free for them for a limited time, but it will be at least 1 year. And they will be able to use it and create content like Stella did and other teachers are doing. And we will try to have like a platform where the teachers can exchange these tasks and activities, because as much as they do it, more people with disabilities or more people without disabilities will be able to use them.
Thank you. And do you think that teachers need specific training to understand the platform so that gifted kids can use it properly?
It was very easy. I can ask this to Stella, but of course we can promote together with Scientix and STEM Alliance. We can promote some webinars, so we can have like 1, 2, 3 hours specifically only for Expressia, because it's very important for us that you can understand like everything that we have there. For example, we could not show it, but we have reports. So we can have like a group of students doing some tasks, and the teacher can share that tasks with the parents or with other people. And they can, after that, they can check the status, for example, of who did it wrong, how long did it take, for example, for that specific student to finish the task. So it will be like a very powerful solution for the teachers to try to understand the development of that individual.
Thank you so much, Jose. Dimitri, I'm not sure if we have you back 100% and if you can address the question now.
Well, can you hear me now?
Yes, perfect.
Perfectly.
Okay, thank you. So I can remember what the question was about equations. And what I was saying, but you didn't hear me, was that I didn't have the chance to face this problem because our courses was about educational robotics and we didn't have equations in those courses. But advice is that I can give when someone has to deal with equations is, first of all, he has to avoid pictures. Equations has to be written in order to be translated and accessible by blind people. And in order to be an understandable content, it has to be step by step and with a lot of explanations written with alternative text. And that's the best I can think about now. But of course, I have to say that it's not the problem that I have faced and modified to test it and see the experience. That's just the what I've read. I'm saying to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And we have another one question for you. Very technical for me to understand, but it reads, regarding predictability, do you have specific examples or tips?
No. Okay. I don't have. I'm sorry for that. It's a difficult subject. It's very interesting. It's something that I'm trying to do, but it's not the magical answer on this. I think it's on the experience of every designer of the course.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And I see that we don't have any other questions. So unless any of our speakers has any final remark, I would sincerely like to thank all four of you for being here today and for delivering this such an amazing webinar and presenting all these tools, applications, and solutions. It's a great pleasure for us, the team at European School, to see you all so involved in projects and your own initiatives and projects and startups. And we really look forward to working further and more with you in the future.